Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, we're going to read verses 8 through 11, the church of Smyrna this morning. The Apostle John writes, "To the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these are the words of him who is the first and the last, who died and came to life again. I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but a synagogue of Satan. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life." Verse 11, "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death." Father, I ask you to come in the power of your Holy Spirit. Illuminate the scripture text this morning. Plant it in our hearts. Show us how to apply it. In Jesus' precious name, amen. In verse 8, the Apostle John, who's been exiled to the Isle of Patmos, writes to the church in Smyrna. And it says, "To the angel of the church in Smyrna," or to the elder there, or to the messenger there, to the one God has placed in charge. Now this morning, I love this lesson because we can literally say who possibly this letter is written to. All right? The bishop of the church of Smyrna was a man by the name of Polycarp, Saint Polycarp. And he was a disciple who was converted under the ministry of the apostles. In other words, that is to say, he knew the Apostle John personally, and he was discipled by the Apostle John personally. Another way to say it is this: the Apostle John was an eyewitness of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He saw the resurrected Christ. He spoke to him. He touched him. He ate with him. So Polycarp is a disciple of someone that saw the resurrected Christ. And this is most likely a letter to him. It's intended to him. Now we're going to speak about him more later. But the thing I love about this is so often people say, "Well, you know, the archaeology and history don't prove the Bible enough for me." That's literally what they're saying. I visited the nursing home this week, and a man came out, and he began to speak to me about all the discrepancies in the Bible and how the Bible, you know, contradicts itself and so on and so forth. It was one of the best times I've ever had at the nursing home. Because I said to him, "Go ahead, let's start one at a time. Let's take them one at a time." And one complaint he had at a time, I was able to give him some things to think about as to whether it was really a contradiction or not. And this morning, the awesome thing to me is we know who this letter was written to, and then we're going to follow through it historically, and you can look it up yourself online. You can look up Polycarp online and see if I'm telling you the truth about him today. And we can see that the words that are spoken here to this church literally come to pass. Jesus identifies himself in the text, if you remember from last week, when he writes a message, when the message is written to the church through the Apostle John, the one that's speaking to John identifies himself. "These are the words of him," it says, "who is the first and the last, who died and came to life again." That's Jesus. And he identifies himself. Remember the point from last week: always identify the voice you're listening to. It's very important that we don't just listen to anybody and take it as truth. And so Jesus, once again, he identifies himself here. Jesus tells them in the church of Smyrna, he says, "Don't be afraid, you're about to suffer." He says, "Be faithful even unto death." Now, have you ever had somebody come and talk to you and tell you something and act like they know what they're talking about, but you know they've never gone through it and they don't really have a clue what they're talking about? And when people do that and they come to me as an expert and they begin to speak to me, I'm thinking to myself, but you haven't done that. You don't know for sure. Now, in this case, the church of Smyrna cannot say that because Jesus is the one who has died and then he has risen again. So when Jesus says to this church, he says, don't be afraid and be faithful even to the point of death. I'm going to give you the crown of life. The people in Smyrna can't go, well, that's what you think, you know, but you haven't gone through it, because he's gone through it. And that's why he says, I'm the one who died and came to life again. And so he identifies himself, and I believe we need to tune our ear to what he's about to say. In verse 9, he starts out like he started out to the Ephesians last week, and he says, I know. He says, I know your afflictions and your poverty. Did anybody come in here this morning, I wonder, wishing you had a little more money? Well, God knows. He says, I know your poverty. Now, if we really look at the text, we're going to see that persecution has taken away the earthly possessions of the people in Smyrna that put their faith in Jesus Christ. It's a concept that we have a very difficult time with here in the United States of America right now. But in the future, I believe we need to read this and understand it so that we can be ready. So he says, I know your poverty. And the point is this, if they stood up for Jesus Christ and if they kept their faith in Christ, they were ridiculed in this church and their possessions were taken away and people did not do business with them. And therefore, they did not have a lot in this world. But then you talk about a contradiction. I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. Yet you are rich. Wealth. Now, the wealth that he is speaking about here is the grace of God and the faith that they have in Jesus Christ that brings them to salvation. And what he talks about by the end of the text where he says, I will give you the crown of life. Now, these are not things that are traded on the board of trade. These are not earthly things that are going to rust and corrode and be stolen and rot away. These are eternal gifts. These are things that will last forever. And so when he writes to the church, he says, I know your poverty. I know where you're at here in this world. But really, you are rich. Later on in this same book, he tells one church, he says, you guys think you're rich, but really, you're poor. And so Jesus brings this into perspective. If you keep your place here, and if you turn with me to 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, listen to what it says. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich. Where was Jesus before he took on human flesh and became a man? You can talk in church. It's okay. He was in heaven. He was with his Father. He had no worries. He had no problems. He had everything he needed. He was in glory, being worshipped. And so the Apostle Paul writes, you know that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor so that you through his poverty might become rich. Jesus said, yes, I will leave the comfort of heaven. I will leave this perfect place because I love those people so much. I will go there and I will redeem them. If you remember the words of Jesus when he walked on the earth, he said, the Son of Man has no place to rest his head. He owned nothing, and yet everything was his. Jesus understands. In the book of James, he continues to bring it into perspective for us. And in the book of James, chapter 2, verse 5, listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? Isn't it great that what we have in our bank isn't what it's all about? That's not what it's about. At the same time, I know some very wealthy men that use everything they have to glorify God, and I love that. So he understands. He commends them. And then if we're back in Revelation, he says to them, he says, I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Boy, those are strong words, aren't they? Let me ask you a question. Has anybody ever come and given you a piece of their mind and unloaded on you? You see, somebody said yesterday. Okay, I'm sorry about that. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 says, life and death are in the power of the tongue. The tongue has the power of life and death. Those who love it will eat its fruit. Do you hear what this says? He says, I know the way they're slandering you. I know the people who claim that they're my children. They say that they're Jews, but really they're of the synagogue of Satan. And what I think Jesus is saying to this church is, listen, I know the fire that you've come under from people's tongues, people who claim to be religious, people who claim to be my kids, but they're really not my kids and they're not worshiping in my house. And he says, I understand and I know how bad it hurts. Sometimes it's people in our own family. Sometimes it's people that we truly love, and they come at us with their tongue. Now, the one way that we're going to experience this, because we are not being persecuted physically like they were back in this time, but the one way that we will experience this, and if you want to test it, feel free, you can test it today. Just go uptown and try to talk to somebody about Jesus. If you're in a school here, if you're in a public school, go to the school and begin to talk about Jesus and bring your Bible and see what happens. The saddest thing to me today is you can go to any public school, you can talk about any God you want to, but the minute you talk about Jesus and the minute you bring your Bible out, you are probably going to be spoken to. And he says to this church, he says, I know what's going on. I know what's going on with their tongues. I know how they come after you. I get it. I want to just exhort you today. Don't grow weary. Don't back off. Don't back off. Now, in this time, this is so close to when Jesus rose from the dead. This is barely a generation, not even a generation away, not even 50 years from the time he rose up from the dead. And there were already heretics moving in and beginning to teach false doctrine. Remember, we talked about Polycarp. Polycarp had a friend at one time, and he began to teach some false doctrine. His name was Marcion. And he claimed that the God of the Old Testament was not the same as the God of the New Testament. And he began to teach this. It was a false doctrine. And he began to write papers on it. And he began to start churches that believed this. As a result, a Roman Catholic church back then excommunicated him. Polycarp stood up to his teaching. The thing I want you to see is already at that time false teachings were coming out. That's why it's so important that we identify the voice that we're listening to and that we test it with Scripture. So he says, I know. Now look at verse 10. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Have you ever seen those great big pickup trucks? I love those big trucks, man. Tires stand this tall. They're way jacked up. And then they have a sign on the windshield that says, no fear. I love it, man. The ground rumbles, you know, when they go by. You know what I found out? If you follow them around long enough, they'll get stuck pretty soon. And you'll find them stuck in the mud, and there'll be a big long cable tied to them, and they'll be trying to get them out, you know. That's not a good kind of no fear. Really, that's just pride and arrogance. And listen to what Jesus says here. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. He says, don't be afraid of that. And he says, I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. It's a very interesting text. What it means is for a short period of time. It means it's a very short period of time in comparison to eternity. If you'll stop with me for just a moment and think about eternity, because what we do here on earth makes a difference where we're at in eternity. And he says, don't worry. Don't worry about the suffering. It's going to be for a short period of time. When you compare it to eternity, it's literally nothing. The Apostle Paul says that I consider this slight persecution I'm going through nothing compared to the eternal weight of glory. That's what he says in Romans chapter 8. And Jesus says to them, don't be afraid of the suffering. Don't fear. It's a short time. Now, in all but one of the other churches that Jesus writes to and he sends this note to, there is a commendation and then there's a censure and a correction. And I want you to know that to the persecuted church here, there's no correction. There's no censure. He doesn't say, I have this against you. Did you notice that? Because you see, they've stood up for Christ and they haven't backed up, and they're paying a price for it. They're paying a price for it. There's a challenge in verse 10 of the text. It says, be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. Once again, a very difficult concept in the United States of America. Be faithful even to the point of death. And then the promise is in there, I will give you the crown of life versus harm by the second death. In verse 11, it says, he who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death. If we research that just a little bit in Revelation and back up to Revelation chapter 20, it's self-explanatory. Beginning in verse 4, it says, I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony for Jesus. Remember the text? Don't be afraid, even unto death. They had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their forehead or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years was ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Church, it's very important that we're in that group. Very important. Look at verse 11 of the same chapter, chapter 20. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. Earth and sky fled from his presence and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. The books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead and were in it. The death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. You know what I'd rather have? I'd rather have forgiveness than being judged for what I've done. So important. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone's name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. Wow. Hear the words of Jesus. If you overcome, the second death will have no power over you. Chapter 21, verse 8. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. You see how clear the Word of God is. That it's a real place. Jesus says, don't shrink back. Don't pull back. Now remember, I told you that history proves this out. And he said, you won't listen to the things that these false teachers say. Polycarp, bishop of the church in Smyrna, at one time made a visit to Rome. Remember the heretic? Marcion and Polycarp had known each other well back east. When Polycarp happened to come across Marcion on the street, he was going to pass without speaking. Marcion stopped him and said, don't you know me anymore, Polycarp? Are you ready for the answer? Yes, answered Polycarp, I know who you are. You are the firstborn of Satan. I'm here to tell you that's very intolerant. And he spoke to this man and he said, you are someone who thinks that you're one of God's kids, and what you're doing is you're speaking heretical teaching against God. If we read the words of John to the church in Smyrna, he says, I know about the people that come and who are speaking falsely about you and trying to change the truth of the Word of God. It's very important. Then he says to that church, he says, now be faithful even to the point of death. He says that the devil's going to put some of you in prison and you're going to come to the point of death. Says, amidst an angry mob, the Roman proconsul took pity on such a gentle old man. Listen to the character of Polycarp, a gentle old man. And they urged Polycarp to proclaim, Caesar is Lord. It says, if only Polycarp would make this declaration and offer a small pinch of incense to Caesar's statue, he would escape torture and death. What would you say, church? What would you do? Would we shrink back? Where would we be? To this, Polycarp responded, 86 years I have served Christ. He never did me any wrong. How can I blaspheme my King who saved me? Steadfast in his stand for Christ, Polycarp refused to compromise his beliefs and thus was burned alive at the stake. If you remember the man who discipled him, the Apostle John, when they put him in oil and boiled him, he did not die. That's why they exiled him to the Isle of Patmos. The encyclopedia says that they lit the wood on fire underneath Polycarp and he wouldn't die. And so they came and they stabbed him to death because the fire wouldn't take him. You see, the enemy will do anything to deal with God's people and get them out of the way. Once again, the validity of God's word. This word came forward to the church in Smyrna. And we can read it in history that it literally happened to them exactly like God said it was going to. And the awesome thing to me is Polycarp did exactly what Jesus said. He would not shrink back. He did not shrink back. Church, it's my goal this morning to convince you to see how important it is that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm going to back up to the book of Exodus because I don't want you to say it's just a New Testament thing. But when Israel sinned against God, Moses was pleading for Israel's life. And Moses says in verse 32 of chapter 32 to God, but now please forgive their sin. But if not, then blot me out of the book you have written. You see, Moses is the type of Christ. He was going to pay the ransom. He said, you take me, Lord, and set them free. Listen to God's answer. The Lord replied to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will blot out of my book. See, God says, Moses, you're in, and that's all there is to it, buddy. It's very important. Listen to the words of Jesus in Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10 and verse 20. The disciples came back, and they were so excited because demons were subject to the name of Jesus. And listen to the words of Jesus. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. If we back up to Matthew chapter 10, what should we really fear, church? Verse 26, Jesus says, do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Isn't this clear? Get our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. When I was first saved, I prayed on a Friday night and asked Jesus into my heart. And the next Thursday, I went to the prayer meeting. And I talked to the man who was about to begin to disciple me. And he laughed at me. He must have had the best laugh because I told him all about how I had given my heart to Jesus. And I had prayed. And I said to him, I said, do I have to sign up someplace? I said, I don't care what you tell me I got to do, but I want to do it, man, because I want to be in, you see. And he started laughing. He said, Dave, your name's written in heaven. He said, you don't have to sign up somewhere, man. You see, church, it's so important. One last scripture verse, verse 27 of Revelation 21. Speaking about the new heaven and the new earth, nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Later on today, I am going to officiate at a wedding, and they asked me if I would pray at the meal. And this is what I'm going to pray, and I do this purposely, and I absolutely love it. I'm going to get up, and I'm going to say, Lord, this celebration that we're having right now at this wedding, it's a forerunner to the wedding supper of the Lamb. You know what happens when you say that in a setting like that? People are going, am I invited to that or not? You see, they're going, hun, did you get the invitation? I want to tell you, the invitation is here. It's from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you're in here right now, you're the one that knows. You see, God's Spirit bears witness with your spirit that you're an heir with Christ. I can't just look at you and tell. I can't just know. I don't have a light to run you under. But it's very simple. If you're in here today and you don't know that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you have to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. You have to believe that He came in the flesh, that He was born of a virgin, that He died on the cross, and that He shed His blood to forgive our sins. If you believe that and then you've admitted that you've sinned against a holy God, then that blood becomes effective for you and it washes away your sins. It just doesn't cleanse you, but it just doesn't forgive you. It cleanses you from all unrighteousness. And if you'll ask Jesus, He'll bring that forgiveness and He'll give you a peace that passes understanding. Then invite the Holy Spirit to come and fill you, and He will fill you and take over your life, and He will begin to lead you and to guide you into all truth. If you've never made that commitment, we are going to pass out the bread in just a moment, and we are going to come to the Lord's table. And you have time between now and then to, all alone with God, to say, Lord Jesus, I want you in my life. I want forgiveness. And you'll be cleansed from all unrighteousness. Father, we've taken your word today. We haven't told many jokes, and we haven't had a lot of fun today. But Lord Jesus, your word is powerful today. And Lord, we've talked about eternal things in a temporal world. And Father, I pray that you would accomplish what you've sent your word to do. And that, Father, right now you would prepare us as we come to the table in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let's go to the table.